sin. I want us to take a particular song. Amen.
Amen.
The goodness of the Lord, the mercy of the Lord, and what He has done for us.
Amen.
I have seen it. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
When I think of the mercies of Jesus. Themselves too. Thank you, Divine. In Jesus' name we pray. I'm talking to you on a good understanding of the parable of the parable of the sower. In the book of Matthew, chapter 13, I read from verse 1. The same day went Jesus out of the house and sat by the seaside, and great multitudes were gathered together unto him, so that he went into a ship and sat, and the whole multitude stood on the shore. And he spake many things unto them in parables, saying, Behold, a sower went forth to sow. In the book of Luke, chapter 5, I want you to know something about the characteristic of this multitude that gathered around him. Verse 1, Luke chapter 5, verse 1. And it came to pass that as the people pressed upon him to hear the word of God, he stood by the lake of Gennesaret, and saw two ships standing by the lake, but the fishermen were gone out of them and were washing their nets. And he entered into one of the ships, which was Simon's, and prayed him that he would thrust out a little from the land. And he sat down and taught the people out of the ship. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
The multitudes, we can see that some multitudes have that desire to hear the word of God. Multitudes pressed Jesus to hear the word of God. It's my prayer that such multitudes will have the right preacher that will bring the word of God to them. But many multitudes today sit before the preacher without the word. They sit before the preacher that has no word of God to tell, but tell stories of no benefit. Now, go back to Matthew chapter 13, where we began to read, and now we want to read verse 4. The Bible says, And when he sowed, some seeds fell by the wayside, and the fowls came and devoured them up. Some fell upon stony places, where they had not much earth, and forthwith they sprang up, because they had no deepness of earth. And when the sun was up, they were scorched, and because they had no root, they withered away. And some fell among thorns, and the thorns sprang up and choked them. But others fell into good ground and brought forth fruit, some a hundredfold, some 60-fold, some 30-fold. Who have ears to hear, let him hear. Now, we will want to compare the statement of Matthew with the statement of Mark, and also with the statement of Luke, to bring out the full presentation of this parable. In verse 4, And when he sowed, some seeds fell by the wayside, and the fowls came and devoured them up. What has Mark to say about the seed that fell on the wayside? Remember, the Lord is telling us a story of a man. Parable is a story. This man went to sow. That he went farming and was broadcasting his seed, spreading them. And his own land has different portions. Different portions. As the seed and the seeds were being broadcasted, they were going to different parts and portions of the land. Now, above all, there are four different portions of the land. The one here is the wayside, the one near the road, where people pass. Matthew said, when he saw some seeds fell by the wayside, and the fowls came and devoured them up. The fowls saw the seeds that were on the wayside and took them, picked them, removed them from the ground, ate them up. That's what the fowls really did. Now, what did Mark say about that? Let's consider Mark chapter 4. You know what Mark has to say about this parable? In Mark chapter 4, verse 2, and he taught them many things by parables, and said unto them in his doctrine, hearken, behold, there went out a sower to sow, and it came to pass, as he sowed, some fell by the wayside, and the fowls of the air came and devoured it up. The fowl came and devoured it up. Luke added another thing about it in Luke chapter 8. Luke chapter 8, verse 5. A sower went out to sow his seed, and as he sowed, some fell by the wayside, and it was trodden down, and the fowls of the air devoured it. Look at the trodden down. Men mashed on them. So the fowls came and picked them up. So you can now have the meaning, therefore, that as the seeds fell by the wayside, what happened? Number one, they were exposed. They were exposed. They were not covered by the soil. They were exposed. Two, men mashed on them. What does it mean? Trod them. Mashed on them. Didn't value them. And the fowls came and picked them up. So that is the way, the one that fell by the wayside. Now, let's go to Matthew again to see the second one. Let's just be doing our comparison and enjoying our story as the Lord is telling us. In Matthew chapter 13, I read verse 5. Some fell upon stony places where they had not much earth, and forthwith they sprang up because they had no deepness of earth. Verse 6. And when the sun was up, they were scorched. And because they had no root, they withered away. See what Matthew is saying here. This one fell on rocky ground. The soil that is underlaid by rocks. And because there was no much soil, they grew up very fast. They grew up very fast. And as they were growing, the Bible says here, the sun rose up and naturally produced its own heat. And then, because this one does not have root, what stopped the root? The underlying rocks. They were scorched, were bumped up, and they died. So, you can see what he's saying. Some fell upon stony places where they had not much earth, and forthwith they sprang up because they had no deepness of earth. And when the sun was up, they were scorched. And because they had no root, they withered away. Why did they wither away? Because they had no root. The answer is so clear. Why did it wither away? Answer me.
Because they had no root.
Because they had no root. Not because there was sun. Because the sun was shining on everything that was upon the earth. It was because they had no root. Then why didn't they have roots? Because there was no much soil there. There had no earth in that place. That is why they had no much root. And because they didn't have root, the heat of the sun burnt them up. Now look at what Mark said about 2-4. Verse 5 and 6. And some fell on stony ground where it had not much earth. Can you see? There was earth, but not much. Not much earth. And immediately it sprang up because it had no depth of earth. Matthew and Mark is telling us something. This came up very fast because there was no much earth. I want us to see this, the mysteries here, because they sprung up very fast, and in the scripture it says, because they had no much air there, to have taken a little more time to develop. They sprung up fast. When I see this, I look at the scripture saying in Luke, chapter 14, that who is he that is building a tower that does not sit down to count the cost? These ones had no time of consideration. That does not sit down to count the cost, whether he has sufficient to finish this building. Lest he started it and his money finished, and he's not able to finish the construction, and men laugh at him. Or else, who is that king that is going for war against another king that does not sit down to consider, will I with 10,000 face the coming king with 20,000? Otherwise, if he considers well and knows that he cannot, then he send another message to the king and says, sorry, I can't come. Let's settle in another way. So that means these ones, well, as we shall understand, did not have time to consider well this decision they are taking. There was no time of consideration because they had no much air. They sprung up very quickly. Now let's go further. Luke chapter 8. Let's know how Luke put it also, chapter 8, verse 6 and so on. And some fell upon a rock, And as soon as it was sprung up, it withered away because it lacked moisture. It lacked moisture. I want us to take note of that word, moisture. Matthew and Mark talked about earth, soil, that it didn't have it. And this one says moisture, which means they think that waters it, that supplies it food, that supplies it food, the moisture, which comes from the soil, it lacks it. It feeds on moisture. But here, because the earth was small around it, it did not have moisture, and so it withered away. Now let's go back to Matthew chapter 13 to read. Another one, we do all this before we go to the Lord's interpretation. In Matthew chapter 13, we read 7. And some fell among thorns, and the thorns sprang up and choked them. Some fell among thorns, and the thorns sprang up and chopped them. Very simple. These thorns, this grass with sharp hooks, sharp, pointed, thorn, pointed, what do I call it? Pointed edges. So they pierce through the crop and destroy them. What does Mark say about it? In Mark chapter 4, the sun. And some fell among thorns, and the thorns grew up. The thorns grew up and chopped it, and it yielded no fruit. Can you see? In Matthew, he said, the thorns that sprung up, in Matthew, it tells us about the thorns that sprung up, choked them, frustrated them, as one is choked by smoke. You cannot breathe because you have been choked up, or maybe you are in the water. You cannot breathe because water has entered into your nose. You are choked up, frustrated. You are, as a result, you die. So Mark also said, these stones grew up, chopped it, and it yielded no fruit. Mark is talking about the result. It did not produce result because the thorns chopped them up. The thorns grew up, which means the thorns didn't attack them. When the thorns were young, it required old age. The thorns have to grow up and gather sufficient strength and allow their piercing fingers to also be strong enough to do it. The thorns could not do it when the thorns were young. So they were living peacefully together. But dangerous anyway. As in process of time, when the thorns became strong, the thorns chopped them up, pierced through them, and they were no more fruitful. They were to produce fruit, but the thorns hindered it, and they perished, no fruit. Now, what did Luke say about it in chapter 8? Of Luke, we read verse 7. And some fell among thorns, and the thorns sprang up with it and chopped it. the tongue sprang up with it. As the seed sprang up, the tongues also sprang up with it. Actually, it's a serious case. It means here is a good person, but someone and a bad person who is in his environment, related with that person closely, and he is not aware until a later day in which this person will hurt him. A later date in which he will be hurt by the person that has grown very closely with him. The thorns grew up with it, sprang up with it, which means they were relating peacefully at the time the fingers were young and tender. There was no trouble. The wind can blow them and they can be rubbing themselves. Nothing happened until the tongues had sufficient strength to tear it down. So this is what we learned. Now let's go back to Matthew to see the last. In Matthew chapter 13, Matthew chapter 13, want to read verse 8. But others fell into good ground and brought forth fruit. Some 100-fold, some 60-fold, some 30-fold. Who had ears to hear? Let him hear. Now, this again tells us that even the good ground is having its own characteristic. Good ground, first class. Good ground, second class. Good ground, third class. Where would you want to be? Praise the Lord. Yes. So, some fell into good ground anyway. Thank God they have made heaven, although the rewards vary. Amen? So, now Mark, what do you have to say about these ones that fell on good ground? Mark chapter 4, verse 8. Another fell on good ground and did yield fruit that sprang up and increased and brought forth some 30 and some 60 and some 100, which means this one produced, the 100 produced perfectly, perfect results. That's my prayer. Let's produce perfectly. Amen. Let's give God a perfect result. Amen. Amen. What is Luke saying also in chapter 8? Luke chapter 8 tells us in verse 8, and others fell on good ground and sprang up and bear fruit and 100-fold. Luke just went to the 100-fold. He didn't divide the classes of the good ground. He went straight and concentrated on the one that brought a 100-fold. Now, praise God for that parable.
Hallelujah.
Now let's go to the interpretation. In the interpretation of the parable, Matthew chapter 13, verse 10. And the disciples came and said unto him, why speakest thou unto them in parable? But now let's move straight to the interpretation which Jesus gave in verse 18. Hear ye therefore the parable of the sower. When anyone heareth the word of the kingdom and understandeth it not, Then cometh the wicked one and catcheth a way that which was sown in his heart. This is he which received seed by the wayside. Now, the wayside is the heart, which shows these different parts of the land represents the different kinds of hearts people here, people have. The different kinds of heart that human beings possess. The different kinds of responses towards the gospel of Jesus. These ones receive the word and don't understand. They don't even bother about it. Remember, they trampled it under feet. They didn't value it. And they didn't value it, the wicked one came in and removed it. Removed the word out of their heart, telling us spiritually Satan can affect the word of God in your life. The presence of God's word in your life can be affected. The devil can remove it. You have it, you don't value it. You don't use it. You don't think about it. You don't examine it. The devil comes and takes it away. It's like a child that is holding money, maybe he's holding dollars. He's holding a dollar or something, let's say, maybe $100 in his hand. And doesn't know, where did you find it? No, I just picked a paper somewhere. If somebody sees that child, I'm not talking about a Christian man anyway, what would he want to do? Since the child doesn't know what he's holding. In fact, he can exchange it with something else. He said, that's your paper, and I just like your paper. Really. Can you take this sweet instead of that paper? The child will freely give it out. So, exactly, that's what Satan does. He comes to people who have heard the word and takes the word out of their life. I was ministering somewhere, and a woman who had the word, it burned through her, and she wanted repentance from witchcraft. I think she saw me for counseling as well. Then we asked, how have you been in this thing for this long? He said, when I come to church, I hear the word. Just at the door, as I'm going, I'm able to vanish it from my life. Everything vanishes from my heart. So I don't even remember anything. Active remembrance is not there. It's not that they may not even know. Sometimes after they don't even know what is being preached. They cannot tell again. But sometimes it is there, but the power of the word working in them, they don't. At the time it was working in them, there should be decision going on in their hearts. There should be repentance going on in their hearts. But they didn't do anything about it. When the celestial stand up to pray, instead of repenting, crying to God about it, I need time, you know, how can I do this? You know, it's not easy. And after that moment, as it gets out, it's gone. It may not even need to get out of the physical church. After the moment of decision, and you do not take that decision, the power of efficacy is gone. And that is how you remain in that state all this while. Why? You are trading under the world. You're marching it underfoot. That precious thing. Conviction is a precious thing. To be convicted in your heart. How many are convicted? That you could be convicted. That's a precious thing. But there is time for everything. To everything, there is time and season for everything under the earth. So, since you didn't bother, that burning in you is grace. For the grace of God that brings salvation has appeared to all men. It burned in you. Did not our heart burn? Well, it's playing with us to take action over some things. But since you didn't do anything about it, the devil removes it. The devil removes it. So that's what the Lord is saying. He said, it tells us here about the interpretation. When anyone hearing the word of the kingdom on any subject, marriage, business, family, evangelism, prayer, repentance, restitution, anything about the word of the kingdom. If anyone, when anyone hearing the word of the kingdom and understandeth it not, does not take time to go through it. Does not take time to meditate on it. Does not take time to receive the conviction that the Lord will give. Or he wanders his mind away. The Bible says, then cometh the wicked one. Then, which means the wicked one is taught to give you time, to think first. God doesn't allow the devil. So you can't say it's the devil that kept you from repenting. No. The wicked one does not come immediately. It comes when you refuse. It comes when you neglect the word. You are trading upon the word. Remember the dollar story. If that boy had quickly seen it and said, no, this thing is of value, and ran to the mother, can somebody else come and take it from him? No. But because you didn't do anything about it, the devil, then the wicked one comes, and God allows him to go and do it. So, then cometh the wicked one, and catcheth away that which was sown in his heart. This is he which received seed by the wayside. Thousands and thousands. How would they say they have no heart? They had. They didn't do anything about it. What about these children that are growing up? Would they say they didn't have? They had. But what does Mark is his presentation on the interpretation? Yeah. In verse 15. Now verse 14 rather. So whatsoeweth the word. Who sows? It can be God himself. The sower can be God himself. The sower also can be the man of God who has the word of God. He sows the word. And these are they by the wayside where the word is sown. But when they have heard, Satan cometh immediately and taketh away the word that was sown in their hearts. Look, Matthew has told us God, although Satan will want to take it away immediately, God has a moment he stops Satan to give you your exercise of free will. It is when you abuse it that you allow the devil to go and do it. That is what happens. But then let's look at what Luke also has to present in the interpretation. as according to the inspiration the Lord gave them, he said, verse 11, now the parable is this, the seed is the word of God. Those by the wayside are they that hear, which then cometh the devil, and taketh away the word out of their hearts, lest they should believe and be saved. Actually, the reason why the devil came is he does not want you to believe and be saved. He does not want you to do righteousness. That is why he came. But Matthew has told us God would not allow him to act until you have been given the chance first. When Ruth came to Boaz and said, redeem the portion that belongs to Elimelech, he said, I have a nearer of kin. Let me give him the first opportunity, the first privilege, to whether he will redeem. If he does redeem, okay, fine. Let's follow the law. If he does not, then I will come. So there is that law, the spiritual law, that God has bound himself and has restricted Satan to give man his free will. First, take your decision before either God or Satan. If your decision favors God, he picks you up. If it is the one Satan should pick up, Satan can go. You get that? So that is what it says. Here, the scripture says, those by the wayside are they that hear. They come in the wicked man, the wicked man, the devil, and take it away the word out of their hearts, lest they should believe and be saved. Come, if the word would be there constantly and be in the meditation, something would have happened. But Satan would not want it. Since you played with it, he quickly wants to remove it. That's what scripture says. I make haste and delay not to keep thy commandment. Mm-hmm. Procrastination is the thief of time. If you procrastinate, it's dangerous. That which thou doest, do it now. Otherwise, you are giving chance to the devil to frustrate you. So, if you want to do righteousness, today, if thou would hear his voice, harden not your heart. Tomorrow is not your day. So, that is what we can learn here. Tomorrow is not your day. Do it now. Now back again to Matthew chapter 13. We read to see the interpretation the Lord gave of the second kind of heart. Verse 20. But he that received the seed into stony places, the same is he that heareth the word and anon with joy received it. Yea, hath he not root in himself, but dureth for a while. For when tribulation or persecution ariseth because of the word, by and by he's offended. See it here. The parable says the seed fell on rocky ground, and that it did not have much earth because there was an underlying storm, underlying rock. It sprung up anyway, but this rock has been there, and the rock hindered progress. The rock hindered progress. When the sun rose up, normal, for the sun shines upon the whole earth, upon everything that is on the earth, everyone, everything, living and non-living, upon the water, upon storms, upon soil, upon human beings, upon families, upon everyone, society, nations, and all, the sun rises up. So the problem has nothing to do with the sun. But we notice something here. There was an underlying rock that was not taken care of. A storm that was there. With time, it hindered it. What could be this storm? What could be this underlying storm? That when you have the world, oh, I like it. In fact, the Bible says, with joy. It was with joy. Listen to what Mark has to say in chapter 4 about this. Verse 16. And these are they likewise which are sown on stony ground, who, when they have heard the word, immediately received it with gladness. Which means they would have continued. But there is an initial thing. Something is there in the bedrock. What is that? There is witchcraft in your life. You have had the word. Get that thing treated. Get it properly confessed. Get that witchcraft properly confessed and submit to deliverance. He that hideth his sins shall not prosper. Shall not prosper. But he that confesseth and forsaketh shall find safety, deliverance, salvation, freedom. But you didn't confess this. In the initial prayer, I gave my life to Christ. Oh, Jesus. There was a kind of a period in which you didn't see the devil come again. But you didn't go back for full confession. The Bible sure tells us in Acts chapter 19 that those who use curious acts came and confessed and did what? And showed their deeds. But you didn't. Is a rock. Well, since you didn't, your salvation will be short. It's an underlying rock. Some things will come and just clear you off. Why? Because you didn't treat that underlying thing in your life. You didn't treat it. Even if you have some charms, you didn't throw it away. You didn't even reveal the one you swallowed in for prayer, and deliverance. So, they frustrate the work. They frustrate your salvation. By and by, as the sun rises up, sun no more. Sun is for blessing, but it's for cursing. For those who are not, who didn't do the truth. So, you can now see, but what could be this underlying thing? It might be your marriage. You didn't marry well. You got this salvation. Good, but you didn't marry well and you didn't treat it. You didn't expose your marriage for proper treatment. As a result, by and by, salvation went. You couldn't continue in salvation. Because how would you continue to commit adultery in salvation? No, it's not possible. By and by, it's gone. There's underlying thing there. There is a fault in you that needed proper confession, proper settlement with someone, proper settlement. You didn't do it. You were joyful. You don't know that thing you left untreated, as you make your bed, so you shall lie on it. So you see why the Christian life didn't continue. Where he didn't find strength, because there was no much air train to continue. Why? You didn't gather the word of God. You didn't amass the power of the world. You didn't lie in the green pasture of the word of God. He made me to lie down in green pasture. But if you're not lying in the green pasture of the world, it cannot prosper. It ended up in the way. Salvation is gone. It started actually, but it's gone. So, it says persecution arose. Was it really persecution that ended it? No. The heart was not determined. The heart didn't prepare. Before the aeroplane takes off, it generates great strength to move. You didn't take time to generate more strength. You didn't take time to sit down and count the cost. You didn't take time to sit down and understand the total demands. You are not willing. You are not willing. As a result, salvation left. Can you see it now? It is not the tough time. It is not the lack of money. It is not the man who came and was bothering you, I want to sleep with you. No, it was not the woman that was easily available for you for immorality. No! Those ones happen to everybody. The sunrises up upon everyone in the air. There's no temptation taking you, but such as is common to man. Everybody faces that temptation. Faces poverty. Faces challenges. Faces this and that. So it's not a challenge. It is that your heart did not prepare. You did not prepare. You were not ready to face shame in your life. You were not ready to bear the cross in your life. That's the problem. You were not ready to bear the cross. You were not ready to expose yourself to shame and despise the consequence. You were not ready. So with the resolve, right, rose up like that. You bow down. Painful. And yet many have known you to be a Christian. You have really made a wonderful impression. You really attracted many people. They felt a star was rising. They were happy. In fact, those of you who children of God were very happy when they saw the way you return. They were happy that they had you. But unfortunately, they didn't know about the underlying bedrock, the storm, the rock. They didn't know about it. That there is a power of frustration which you prepared for yourself. There's what is called the evil day. When the evil day came, it found you prepared for it to pay off. And it gives sorrow to people. It gives sorrow. It's like a mirage that appears to be water in the wilderness. What a hope it gives to the thirsty man in the wilderness. Oh, I'm seeing water there. On top, that I look afar, there's water there. What a frustrating image it presents to the animal in the wilderness, in the desert. They run there, will find solace, will find satisfaction. But they went and discovered that it was a mirage. Your life became a mirage. The pastor was rejoicing, I found someone. someone to use, someone that will walk with me, someone that walk together we shall do greatly. But you discover you are not prepared. You didn't prepare your heart. You didn't prepare your life. You disappointed people. God disappointed in your life. You see how painful. Please, this is a serious case. I'm saying this that as you go to begin again, you must deal with that rock. Go and deal with that rock. Don't fear. Don't be ashamed. Get the matter exposed. Let it be well treated. In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Now, look at it again. Back to what does Luke say about that subject? In Luke chapter 8, about this issue, verse 13. They on the rock are they, which when they hear, receive the word with joy, and this have no root. Which for a while believe, and in time of temptation fall away. Simon the sorcerer, the Bible said, he believed also. Is that not so?
Yes, sir.
But he didn't confess his witchcraft. He didn't confess his witchcraft. And so when he saw demonstration of power, it was his time of temptation. He wanted to use money to buy it. Because it will give him power. So you can see the whole thing. If you fail, don't say God caused you to fail. Don't say God doesn't like you. Same condition. Others are sincere, you are not. Others are total, you are halfway. Cannot walk. Others are walking with two legs and are going, but you are walking with one. How far? How far do you walk with one leg? What about when you see a beast? What will you do? That's the time of your temptation. That's the problem. So, that is it, my brother. That is it, my sister. Now, let's go back to Matthew. Chapter 13. Matthew chapter 13, I read verse 21, and verse 22 rather. He also that received seed among the thorns is seed that heareth the word, and the care of this world, and the deceitfulness of riches choke the word, and he becometh unfruitful. The cares of this world and the deceitfulness of riches and the cares of other things, worries of life, ambitions of life, he had the word in his life, he becometh unfruitful. This one don't have problem with the soil. It is not in the wayside. It is not on rocky ground. It was, in fact, I want to suppose it was, I would have said it was a good soil because it sprang up well. But it's bad because there was thorn with it. There was thorn that sprang out of it. Actually, it looks sorrowful. These ones give us sorrow. Why? You are born in a family, or she was born in a family, or he lives in a family where frustrating agents are there. He gives his life to Christ, but maybe the mother, the father, the brother, the sister, or else a married person, the wife or the husband, picks him up. They're working closely together. They lie side by side. They live together. But this one gradually develops So, these ones, just one of them, either together or one, develop strong. Hallelujah. Develop strong opposition against him, against her, against the boy, against the man, against the woman, against the girl, that the Christian life couldn't continue again. Strong opposition. The Christian life couldn't continue. The opposition was strong. Actually, was it the opposition that was strong? No. His case is like the case of Oprah. Oprah said, when she was presented a strong reason, it affected her will. She was told, return again, my daughter, because I am an old woman. By law, of course, it is a relation of mine or my child that should marry you. Now, I have no hope. I have left home now for more than how many years? My hometown. For more than how many years? In fact, I don't appear to know the people there well now. So I cannot promise you that I have a relation in Bethlehem that will marry you. No. Oh, it grieved me much because of what God has allowed on my way. Return back to your homes. Even if I'm got married, where I'm going and get back to a child today, suppose today I even get back to a child, would you wait for that child? Can you see appealing reason? This one had appealing reason. They had appealing reasons. The reasons were logical. Return. Return home. Can you wait for the child that I may give birth today? If suppose I could give birth today. By the time he grows up, will he not be an old woman? Mm-hmm. Return home. And may God give you a husband. And bless you. Which blessing that does not include heaven? What blessing are you looking for that does not include the blessing of heaven? Oprah was promised that blessing, a relief, immediate quenching of her thirst. But it's not talking about the thirst of tomorrow. Immediate satisfaction of her fleshly desire. There was nothing spiritual attached to it. Nothing spiritual attached to it. So that's what I'm talking about, these stones, what they can do. And why the crop fell is altogether fleshly, external. But I pity it because it was actually external force that exerted great pressure that affected the will of that person. See how many wives are changing from standard because of their husbands. Mm-hmm. Imagine. She meant it. She wanted to serve God. She didn't know that I have not come for peace. For war I have come into this world. That's what Jesus said. That a man's falls should be day of his household. That in the house, will be divided against one against the other. There will be division between the father and the daughter-in-law, the mother-in-law and the daughter-in-law. Yet division between a husband and a wife. For this have I come into this world. This one don't know this. The condition should be peace, pleasurable, favorable, comfortable. That's what they're thinking. That's what they feel. It could be a friend. Maybe now you're in the holiness movement. You are not aware that Satan has planted people in the movement. They are not aware. And these people are very, are growing with it. When they started, they were very innocent and sincere. Well, not sincere, but sincere, innocent. Because their teeth could not destroy at that time. It's prepared upon a set time. It's like the locusts that were still expecting them because they were prepared for a set time to sting human beings. And they still will last for how many months? 6 months. You remember the Revelation? So, these ones are prepared upon the evil day. Waiting for when the devil will now make. Strike now! You have got to your friend. Strike! These ones are among you. And you are not vigilant. You are not prayerful. You are not watchful. You are not studious. You are not praying for the ability to discern. You are not studying the signs of the Lord. You are not doing that. And this one strike at you. Before you know it, you get initiated. You get initiated. And since he gradually worked on your coming out of Christ by gradual provocation, continuous provocation, continuous troubling, continuous accusation. As you react to the accusation in anger, as you answer back in wrath, your spiritual energy is being sapped. As it challenged your person, you rise up in pride. Your spiritual grace or virtues are being sapped. Until Samson has come to the point, Philistines can now come. That's it. Oh, for unfortunate that the enemy picked you up like that. That the enemy really, really, of course, it's so tight around you. That you have this tongue around you, growing up, pinching you, biting you, troubling you, rubbing upon you, seeking to pierce through you, constant, until you can now come up to the point and say, okay, let's face each other. That's what he has been waiting for since. Because the whole purpose is get out of the faith. Get out of the way. It is not, the Bible says, we wrestle not against flesh and blood. That's number one. Two, the Bible says our warfare, the weapons of our warfare are not carnal. Though we walk in the flesh, we war not after the flesh. The whole thing is spiritual. It's not matter of the flesh. When you convert it to the flesh, let's go, spirit has gone. The spiritual has gone. Tongues around you. Active. Beautiful, radiant person, actually. Very useful person. The enemy sends someone in to begin to pursue you. Begin to pursue you. How many have been silent because of marriage? Very wonderful woman. Growing up with brilliance. The enemy sent a man there who also lived with her in the same church, doing the same thing, because the tongues at first they live together. Is that also? Very, very closely. But the fingers were soft. They couldn't pierce through. It's gradual as the tongues sprung up. As they were growing together, the fingers were growing stronger. Sister, something is planted around you for your doom. The devil has done this. It's a human being like you, it's in fact a close friend. If it were an enemy that smote me, I would have borne it. But it is a friend like you. We took counsel together. We walked together. We ate together. I never suspected you. If it were an enemy that smote me, I could have taken it.
Not how. So can you see it? You see how the Christian that is getting is unfruitful? A beautiful man of God getting a wife. And the wives are struggling. Daughters of Jezebel. Very innocent at first. Very innocent at first. Very innocent. Or else, the person close to you is a witch. It's a wizard. And is going to spend years in with you in evangelism. In everything. But how to initiate it and bring it to witchcraft. Before you know it, great you is inside with us. How did it happen? It was a plan of 20 years with a man, a close friend. A plan of 20 years with a woman, a close friend. A loving one with Jesus. But altogether, how you didn't hear the word of God? My son, hear my word. Put it in your heart that it should deliver you from the strange woman, from the stranger, who's flattered with her lips. Her hands are buns once she catches you. Hey! So that is how it is. Why did you fall eventually? If thou faint in the day of adversity, it's because all this while you have not been gathering much strength, your strength is small. Your prayer life, they work on your prayer life. Why didn't you cry when you noticed that your prayer life was going away? Why didn't you cry out to God when you noticed that your devotional life with God was going? Because some foods, they are sending you some gifts of cloth, some food and drinks, they were weakening you gradually. Weakening you gradually. Weakening you gradually. You see that prayer life is gone. Yes, they're still going on. They're taking a stage before you will appear in water. If you rush up at the time you sense weakness and cry, nothing will happen. All the while, Samson's hair was still on his head. No Philistine came. Because energy was there. I will rise up when the Philistines are upon you. Where are they? I will rise up and fetch them. Everybody, be on your knees. I mean, be on your heels. Because Samson is still strong. His hair was on his head. But Delilah was doing her business. My prayer is that the Lord will deliver you from this subtle enemy that came for your soul.
Amen.
It can happen for a whole church. He played great zeal and you carried the church and gave him. Carry the church and gave her. Very simple. Gradually. Gradually. Much noise is going on in the pulpit, but great weaknesses are being noticed in the congregation. That is it. Much activities, innovations, these ones are coming up, songs are being sung, prayer, night vigils, but the result. It's all deceitful. All deceitful until the church has lost its own power. Before you know it, some start dying. Sacrifice to the devil. Many are initiated. Oh God, thank you for revealing this.
Amen.
May the Lord make you useless.
Amen.
In vain is the snare laid in the sight of any bird. When a bird sees you putting a trap for it, it can never come in there. Whatever you put inside there, whatever food, whatever thing, it will never come. As you have discovered it, they shall never catch you.
Yeah.
Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
So, now, you see Jesus also here said, but this desire of riches. Desire of riches. Yes. of this world, the deceitfulness of riches, the honor that comes from riches. Oh, you have bought another car. Your beauty has come. What would it have to do for you? What shall it profit a man if he gets the whole world? You have gotten a favor from this in somebody, a man. Oh, you found favor in the sight of this man. Is that giving you day? Is that giving you day? There is also going to be received, because there is a law, giving and receiving. Paul was writing to the Philippian Christians about the law of giving and receiving. As you are receiving, you will also give. You also give. So that is how it is. Cares of this life. I don't have money. I don't have this. I don't have this. God, if you don't give me this, God, if I don't marry this year, God, against yourself. Let's look at what Mark has to say about this one. Mark chapter 4. Mark chapter 4. Verse 15. And these are they by the open, and these are they which are sown among thorns, such as hear the word, and the cares of this world, and the deceitfulness of riches, and the lust of other things entering in, chop the world, and it becoming unfruitful. Lust of other things. Deceitfulness of riches. I want to marry a beautiful woman. I want to marry a man that is like this, like lust of other things. I want lust of other things. Entering in and chop the world. The world is for heaven, not on earth. The world is for heaven. Its own aim is to prepare you for heaven. But why are you so full of the earth? Why are you so much in sorrow because you miss anything on earth? Because of not marrying, you are so much in sorrow. You have not gotten a child. You are so much in sorrow. You have not gotten a job. You are so much in sorrow. You have not gotten, what is the problem? These things are of the earth. Why are you so full of yourself? Full of pains and sorrows, they will chop the world. They will take away your heart from heaven. What is Luke saying about it in Luke chapter 8? Luke chapter 8. We want to read verse 14. And that which fell among thorns are they which, when they have heard, go forth and are choked with cares and riches and pleasures of this life, and bring no fruit to perfection. I want you to know what Luke said about the fruit. He said, and bring no fruit to perfection. While Mark said, and other things entering in chops the world, and it becoming unfruitful. While Matthew and Mark talk about unfruitfulness of the seed that fell among thorns, because Matthew said, and becoming unfruitful. Luke said, it is not really that it didn't produce anything, the seed that fell among thorns. It's not that it didn't produce anything. It produced fruit according to its kind. And that meant nothing to the Lord, because there was no perfection in the fruits. To look, why bothering about talking of imperfect fruit? It is unfruitfulness. He was unfruitful. Mark said, why bothering of saying he produced anything at all when there is no fruitfulness? It was unfruitful. Luke said, he produced something. I can understand. It only that what it produced had no use. They are all speaking the same thing. Is that clear? You can see this corn that produced chaff. Have you noticed it? It produced, but it's chaff. If you shake it, it's full of dust. No seed is there. No green. Matthew said, the seed was unfruitful because the end of it has no meaning.
Mark said, the seed was unfruitful because the end of it has no meaning, of no use, of no benefit. Luke said, actually, it has some fruit, but the fruit has no meaning. So it is, what Matthew is saying is correct. What Mark is saying is correct. You, by your, the nature of your life, you may think you are doing Christianity, but it has no meaning. Those things you are doing have no meaning. They are not perfect. Paul said, what I am striving is to present you perfect before God. These ministers are producing people, but they are not perfect. And so have no meaning. Nobody is going to heaven there. It's unfruitful. They are full. I need money. I need fame. I need this. We need this. We need to build this. We need to do that. And because they are the cares of this life filled there, they produce fruit according to their kind. And their fruits have no meaning. They have no benefit to eternal life. They have no benefit to the eternal God. They are unfruitful. Thank God for the lesson we have learned today.
Amen.
You know, holiness revival movement came up. When holiness movement came, there are people that ran to it with joy. Yes! Hallelujah! Hallelujah! They didn't sit down to consider it well. Amen.
Amen.
Others were on the wayside. Those ones immediately they had this and who can do this one? Hallelujah. They had all the testimony, they had all the revelation, they had the teaching of the world. Who can be doing that? They said like those who gathered at the Pentecost, these men are drunk. They are wayside people. They are full of new wine. Praise the Lord.
Hallelujah.
And they went their own way. They are the people that have Jesus. Say, are you still listening to him? This man is mad. He has a devil. Are you hearing?
Yes.
He has a devil. Are you still listening to him? They are wayside people. But the others, hey, wonderful. Yes, God has given us new movement. It is the art. It is the art. Let's watch them. Just because they didn't come with all their hearts, the things they needed to do, the preparation, the totality of themselves, they needed to yield to God, they didn't do it. The restitutions they needed to carry out, they didn't do it. And so the thing, little temptation, persecution. Hey, my husband said that if I remove jewelry, the marriage has finished. Me, where will I carry my children to? The whole thing is because there has been a storm in your heart. Everybody said the storm is in her heart. She didn't remove it. That is why she's calling her husband's name. Praise the Lord. That's the whole thing. You would have done, you didn't do. The persecutions of your husband, the persecution of the government, the persecution of witches and wizards, whatever you call them, they are not the main thing because all of us pass through the wind. All of us. Why did we not fall? And you're the one falling. You didn't prepare. That's when you went back. Dog. The dog has gone back to her vomit. That's it. Then there is these ones too. They fell among tongues. That's terrible. There are critics around them. Agents of end time revival. I mean, agents against end time revival. Because the devil himself is aware that the Messiah will be born and prepare Herod for it. Prepare people for it to ensure it, the Messiah be destroyed. And these agents are planted in different places.
And this our beloved brother, this our beloved sister came across one of these agents. They began to work on her. Began to talk stories that are not even true. Began to tell negative things about holiness revival movement. About the man of God, about that woman, about that our coordinator. You don't know them. We know them. We have been there. Me, I've been there now since 2013. Praise the Lord. I began to pour things on this girl, on this woman. I began to walk. And unfortunately for him, he didn't verify. The Bible says verify. Make diligent search. Make inquiry to see whether this thing this person is telling you is true. Take it to God in prayer. Let the Lord confirm. Ask me. I will speak to you. I will tell you. My sheep hear my voice. Yes. If you are my sheep, why didn't you come? Why didn't you hear my voice? Come and ask me. I will tell you. He didn't do it. She didn't do it. And this agent carried her off. Carried him off. Or else, he's among witches and wizards. He was playing zeal. All these messages, we say, listen to them. She was not listening to them. No reading Bible. We say, pray at least 1 hour. He's really a leader. He's not praying. And these people walk to initiate her into witchcraft. You see how dangerous. Or else, they want to use holiness movement for advantage. Because it brings us in connection with other people in other parts of countries in Europe, countries in various parts of the world. I can associate with them. Please, what's your number, sir? What's your number, ma'am? It becomes a business venture. Deceitfulness of riches and the lust of other things. Not the word of God, not the kingdom of God anymore. Destroyed the true spirit of God in his life, and he became unfruitful. He's found himself doing something, but there's no perfection there. I am doing something, but God is not valuing what you're doing. There's no perfection in what you're doing. Your fruits are like yourself. But then go back and let's look at the last thing. In Matthew chapter 13, Matthew chapter 13, verse 23. But he that receiveth seed into the good ground is he that heareth the word and understandeth it, which also beareth fruit and bringeth forth some a hundredfold, some 60, some 30. Good ground. God. Sometimes I will say, hey, when I hear a report on this leader, on that leader, on this person, on that person, I say, wonderful. These people are not hearing this thing we're preaching. Hey, trouble has come. These other churches couldn't do it. I will say, God, we're going to do this thing for you. And if key persons are failing like this, hey, what is the hope? But when I also come to hear testimonies of others, oh, pastor, the word of God, this is what I do to keep myself. In fact, I did this restitution. And they will even call me to be asking questions. I will just look and say, this man has understood this word. So when I see the people who have understood the word and are practicing it, I say, bless God, Lord, thank you. Something is happening. Praise the Lord. If you see yourself doing fine, you're encouraging us. If you're doing evil with all this knowledge of the world, you're weakening us. Altogether, the Lord is encouraging us.
Because he is the one that suffers the most. Disappointment of human beings. But he has hope. The Lord has hope. I have hope. Because love hopeth all things. And God is love. God hopeth all things. And we who have God in us must hope all things. Going on. Good shall come.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Certainly, the knowledge of truth shall fill the earth.
Amen.
Certainly, righteous people for end time revival shall spring up in the
earth.
So, look at what is the Bible says. Now, see what Mark also said about the Mark chapter 4, verse 20. And these are they which are sown on good ground, such as hear the word and receive it and bring forth fruit, some 30-fold, some 60, and some 100, maybe according to the various characteristics of the ground. But they brought forth fruit. They may not yield at the same stage because the talents the Lord gave, he didn't give the same talent. Some 5 talents, some 2 talents and 3 talents, some 1 talent. So according to their talent, so what their production. So praise God. One thing is they were fruitful. They were good ground. Now what does Luke say about it in Luke chapter 8? Luke chapter 8 verse 15. Let's read it together. Are you there? Luke 8 verse 15. 1, 2, go. But that on the good ground are they which in an honest and good heart, having heard the word, keep it and bring forth fruit with patience. This is wonderful. Having heard the word, keep it. They keep it, that they practice it. It's not just hearing. Be ye not hearers of the word only, but be ye doers. If he that is a hearer of the word and not a doer, the same is like he that watches himself in the mirror. Because after hearing the word, your life is being revealed. Your weaknesses are being revealed. What the assignments of the Lord to you are being revealed, delivered unto you. But if you do nothing, you just go your way, you will forget. But be ye doers. He that is a doer, himself will be blessed in all his ways. So the good ground are doers of the word. They hear it, they keep it. But they see another thing there. They bring forth fruit with patience. Who told you that there's no suffering in the gospel of Christ? That there's no attack. Nobody must speak against you. Nobody must criticize you. Satan is doing everything to make you offended. He is doing everything to cause your relationship with God to break. Sometimes even the people you're doing good to will be kicking you. Jesus went to the gatherings and healed a madman there. And they came to him and said, read this verse. Eh? This man that had been fighting you on top of the mountain, I came to set him free. He said, should leave. He said, leave this place. Our pigs are dying. He didn't challenge them. Did he not believe?
Yes, sir.
But if it were you, what would you have done? Yes, you would have been angry. You said, these people, I don't know what will ever bring me to this place again. If I would clean my feet. There must be patience. Otherwise, you cannot make the kingdom. The gospel of Christ is called the gospel of his patience. God is patient with man. You must be patient with all men. Patience of
also because the husbandman waited patiently for the fruit of his labor. Patiently. They will not come on time. Sometimes, no money. Sometimes, you're not finding the converts. Sometimes, the converts are giving trouble. One person who is now an overseer was giving his testimony. He said when the brother who brought him to the Lord, the brother disturbed him so much, so he gave his life to Christ. No, before he gave his life to Christ, the brother, I know you have promised the brother, yes, I will serve Jesus. He said when he sat somewhere and saw the brother coming, he will sneak away. He will run to another side where he won't see him. But the brother will continue. The brother will continue with patience. I will come. I don't worry. Is it tomorrow? Please tell me what time. It's tomorrow 5 o'clock. All right, 5 o'clock. 10 minutes to 5, I'll be there. Me, I don't like coming late to a place. You thought that you are going to the singer's company. 10 minutes to 5 is not there. 5 is not there. 20 minutes after 5, 6 o'clock. Your face is almost looking outside. It's almost looking outside. Until he didn't come, he had to smile. I will abandon him with patience. May the Lord give you patience.
Yeah.
Do the work with patience.
Yeah.
The Lord is the one that rewards our labors.
Yeah.
Exercise patience. Let patience have a perfect work, that ye may be perfect and entire, wanting nothing. Be patient in your tribulation. Be patient before the Lord in waiting for answers to prayers. Be patient. Be patient with all men. May God make you a fruitful ground.
Amen.
May Jesus find you fruitful.
Amen.
May the Lord use you to populate the kingdom.
Amen.
Let's rise up upon that feet and worship. Worship the Lord. Worship the Lord.
Worship the Lord, loving Father, that has brought this great depth revelation to you, to us, this evening. We appreciate you. This is to save you. This is to make sure that you make it to heaven. Worship Him. Worship the Lord. Depth teaching because of the love of God to save you from being choked, being cut out, being burnt by the sun. That's a great work he has started in your life. Worship him. He is able to keep you. To keep you perfect, to keep you holy till the end. Worship him. All this is to make sure that you remain pure. Worship him. Yes. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
We are going to pray seriously for some minutes before we close. Amen.
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 The Lord has given us a wonderful message this evening. And this message must have impact in your life. Amen.
Amen.
I'm sure you didn't know before that there are thorns that with their touch in the beginning is caressing. Because they are soft. As they are touching you, you are feeling as if they are consoling you, you know, being happy and all that. But little did you know that gradually, those caressing fingers will turn to thorns that will destroy a man. that will destroy a woman. Today, the Lord has opened your eyes. I want you to open your mouth and say, every Delilah, every subtle enemy that is growing to attack, to destroy me, the Lord expose them. Open your mouth and say, Lord, expose them. Expose and uproot from my life. Every Delilah that is gradual, doing a gradual work in my life to destroy me from every corner, from whoever and whatever, the Lord uproot from my life. Open my eyes to see this subtle enemy that will soon grow a knife, a jackknife. I'll be coming away from the Lord. Lord, expose them. Expose in my life. Expose in my life. Every Delilah that will pop out the strength of God in your life, Lord, expose. Expose. Before it becomes killing, before it becomes a mother individual in your life, that will kill, that will slaughter, that will lend you, Lord, expose. Expose them. From your chapter, every agent that is inside that will be growing, that will become strong enough to destroy the grave, Lord, expose, expose, expose. Let the scorching fire from heaven come down and expose, expose this storm. Kill them from the roots or root them from the under. This Lord expose and take away before it becomes mortal. Take the decision to kill them right now. Kill those tongues that is rolling. Destroy them. Destroy them. Let them not receive minds that will make them stronger. No. Let them be rotting from the roots and try before they become dangerous. In Jesus' name. Force, exerting energy, gradual energies ready to strike, that we grow to strike. Lord, remove the energy from this point. Let's open our mouth and pray. Every force, external, internal, from wherever, that is growing in energy. Today is the end of the energy they are receiving. We cut them away from whatever energy that is coming to make them strong enough to attack. Today is the end of the battle. Pray that the Lord will take them away. Remove, block the flood of energy, of strength, of electricity from them right now. So that it will be dead. Every force, let it be quenched right now. In the name of Jesus. Yes, yes. Remove and flood from the source. Let his powers be removed right now. That you may grow, that I might grow. Grow to be a fruit. In Jesus' name we pray. Open your mouth and ask God for the spirit of discernment. We need it. You need it. Because without you, you will not even know what is happening. You don't know who is friend, you don't know who is friend enemy. Ask the Lord, please, God, grant me the spirit of discernment to know when the enemy is around me. Open your mouth and pray. It's all power from above to discern when the enemy is approaching. Those subtle words, request of friendship. Yes, Lord, grant me the spirit of discernment, Lord, to see them and know them. To detect them, Lord. Yes, Lord. To identify them, Lord, when I see them. In the name of Jesus. And to be careful from the beginning. Yes, Lord. Open our eyes, O Lord. Open our eyes to see every corner, Lord, where we find ourselves. In every unit, in every chapter, every nation, every region, every soul. In your life, in your family. Yes, Lord. Spirit of discernment, Lord. Yes, Lord. To fish them out early, Lord, before they start. how to take the right decision at the right time.
Amen.
Is it about marriage? Is it about restitution? Is it about relationship? What is it about remaining in the movement? Whatever decision that has to be done, that the Lord Himself will grant you the grace to do the right decision.
Amen.
Open your mouth and ask from the Lord. If you will ask, then the Lord will grant you God's grace. Those that test and seek for righteousness, the Lord promised that He will give it to them. Upon the things of God. Revival in the interest of the things of God. Open your mouth and ask of the Lord. A good ground.
Amen.
You see, the whole parable is about the state of the heart.
Yeah.
If it's ready, fertile to receive, then when the seed drops there, you will do all that you need to do immediately and the work is done. Amen.
Amen.
Present your heart to the Lord and the heart of the members of your unit and chapter, that their heart will be the heart that is fertile, ready to receive the fruit, the seed that the Lord is sowing, the word of God. Pray for your own heart.
Amen.
Jesus' name we pray.
I want us to pray for the grace for patience.
Very, very important. Very important. It's the advice of the prophet. You curse the children of God, nothing will happen, because you cannot curse the people that God has blessed. But if you can get them to offend their own God will curse them. And that's what the enemy is working. So I want us to pray. The Lord will grant me patience. Patience to practice the word of God. Patience to practice holiness. Patience to wait for the fruit of the work that we are doing. Open your mouth and ask for the patience. Patience to bring forth perfect fruit. Lord, went straight for the perfect fruit. There is no need, if you are going to do something, why not do, just get the best. Amen.
Amen.
So I want us to pray for the perfect fruit. Lord, make me fruitful.
Amen.
Give me perfect fruit.
Amen.
Open your mouth and ask for that. Perfect fruit. Pure and good. Blameless. The kind of the fruit. The best of the fruit. Yes, Lord, make me fruitful. Use me, Lord, for that. prayer point. Lord, restore the joy of our salvation. As we enter with joy, that we will continue with joy. We will not lose our path. We will not be those that we fall by the wayside, but we will continue to walk with the Lord, just like Enoch, till the end, until the Lord will take us up in heaven. Lord, restore the joy, that we will continue to remain peaceful and glad, yes, and courageous, bold and firm in the things of God, till the end, until the Lord comes. Because for those that endure through many tribulation, we will get there at the end. Yes, Lord. What a wonderful Father. Father, we thank you. Father, we thank you. Who are we, Lord, that you are mindful of us? Glory to your holy name. Look at the wonderful words, Father, that you have given to us today. Another word of revival. Another word to keep us till the end. Father, we thank you. We appreciate you, Lord. Father, you have come so far to come and find us, Lord. Father, we pray that you will keep us till the end. In Jesus' holy name, we pray. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. We appreciate, Lord. We appreciate, Lord. Father, we bind every activity of the enemy around us. Father, the enemy shall never prosper. Amen. Only your will, Lord. Amen. Only your will. Amen. Your children shall make it to the end. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Holiness Revival Movement has produced a list of books and DVDs that will help every believer to build sound knowledge and understanding into biblical holiness. Escaping Hellfire and Entering Heaven Made Simple. Divine Revelation and Scriptural Exposition on Believers' Clothing and Adornment. Delightful Revelation of Heaven and How to Get There. Worshiping God in the Beauty of Holiness. Daily Devotional. Every Word of God for Daily Living and much more. Get these divinely inspired products aimed at promoting Bible truth, righteousness and practical holiness in the life of a believer and the Christian family. They will turn every reader into a holy and sincere Christian and a zealous worker and a true Bible teacher. All our products are available by calling any of our telephone numbers and by visiting the website. Holiness Revival Movement, promoting righteousness and holiness worldwide.
Holiness, no one can be with God without. No one can please the Lord.